Good evening and welcome to the Ethel M Wood Lecture 2019, which will be delivered by Lena Sophia Thiemeyer from Aberdeen University. Before I get to introduce Lena, I just wanted to say that directly after this lecture, there will be some time for questions and answers, and thereafter we shall adjourn just next door. If you sort of turn back on yourself, go outside, turn right again, the Anatomy Museum, where there will be some drinks and nibbles, and I hope to see some of you there. And there will be more opportunity to grill Lena after her, I'm sure, fantastic talk in a minute. It is really my very great pleasure to introduce Lena as this year's speaker. She is, I regard her as my older doctor sister. We share the same supervisor. And we also share quite a lot of interests from perhaps somewhat different perspectives at times, but we often meet in the middle, which is, I find, often very interesting. Lena is extremely well published, I believe four monographs by now, and around about seven or eight edited volumes, some on her own, some together with other speakers. One very, very hot off the press earlier this year on prophecy and its cultic dimension in the supplements to the Journal for Ancient Judaism. If you go on her profile on the Aberdeen website, you can click through to her publications, and there's about 70 or 80 more articles. So if you want to learn some of Lena's thought, then I recommend doing that. This paper tonight is the fruit of her work on the reception history of the book of Jonah in both Christianity and Judaism, and hence the title is quite apt, namely the Book of Jonah in the Jewish Christian debate.
Thank you very much. It's a great privilege being here, and I've been told about my illustrious predecessors, and I am duly awed. I'm going to talk about Jonah in Jewish Christian polemics, and I'm going to quote a number of people with, I would say, rather deplorable opinions. So please bear that in mind, that when I quote people, these are not my opinions, but opinions of the people that I quote. And that goes for most of the people that I'm going to quote tonight. So I apologize in advance for some of the thoughts and viewpoint that I am going to discuss and interact with. So the Book of Jonah has been used, and actually very often misused, in Jewish Christian dialogue and polemic. The reasons are manifold, but two mutually contradictory issues stand out. Namely that one, Jonah is a narrow-minded Jew who does not wish Gentiles to experience God's grace. And that two, Jonah is a type for Christ, who, like Jesus, died and was resurrected. In the present paper, we shall look at the interrelated ways that Jews and Christians over the last two millennia have battled with one another and used the Book of Jonah as one of their chief weapons. Interpretation of biblical texts seldom exists in a vacuum. First, we shall discover how the respective Jewish and Christian canon has been a major motivating factor in interpreting Christian traditions, Christian interpretations often stem from dialogical readings of the Old and the New Testament, whereas Jewish interpretations tend to be strongly influenced by the canon of the Hebrew Bible. Second, a Christian interpretation may often trigger a Jewish counterinterpretation and vice versa. We shall here explore the dynamic behind this interchange and highlight what textual issues and religious preconceptions gave rise to a given interpretation. I shall address six topics. One, the character of Jonah. Was Jonah a narrow-minded and disobedient Jew, or a hero who sought to save Israel? Two, the sailors. First, did the sailors convert to Christianity or Judaism? Second, were they Christ-killing Jews or members of the Christian Inquisition? Three, to whose vanity is Jonah 2:9 referring? The idols of the Gentile sailors or the institution of rabbinical Judaism? Four, the people of Nineveh, was their repentance sincere or mere pretense? Five, the worm. Yes, we are going to talk about the worm in Jonah 4:7. And six, the message of the book of Jonah. Is it about God's mercy or his failure to be just? First, though, a word of caution. My presentation focuses on the big picture, and many exceptions abound. So, starting with Jonah. The biggest conundrum in the book of Jonah, unless, of course, you speak about the physical size and then the fish wins the competition, concerns the reason for Jonah's initial refusal to obey God's command to go to Nineveh and foretell its doom. We read in Jonah 1:2. Rise, go to Nineveh, the great city, and call out against it, because its evil has risen before me. Instead, Jonah decides to flee. Later, Jonah hints at his motivation as he admits that God is, quote, a gracious and compassionate God, slow to anger and abounding in love, a God who changes his mind with regard to planned evil in Jonah 4:2. Jonah thus sought to prevent the repercussions of what we may call God's habitual compassion. Jonah's understanding of God's underlying motives for sending him to Nineveh, expressed in Jonah 4:2, is fully in line with the ancient Near Eastern understanding of prophecy. Its aim was not its fulfillment, it was its cancellation. In other words, the prediction of Nineveh's disaster was the beginning of its cure. It served as the essential impetus to bring about Nineveh's repentance, which, according to this reading, was God's goal in the first place. This insight raises another question. Why did Jonah wish to prevent God from showing mercy upon the Ninevites? Or, expressed differently, why did he desire to vouchsafe God's destruction of the city? Here, Jewish and Christian interpretations diverge, but as mentioned earlier, this division is not watertight and there are instances of overlap. Whereas most Christian interpreters ultimately accuse Jonah of being intolerant as he wished to deny God's grace to the people of Nineveh, many Jewish interpreters seek to rehabilitate Jonah by providing him with honorable motives. So, why did Jonah flee? A standard explanation shared by both Jews and Christians, Jews, for example, in Perkei de Rabbi Eliezer 10, chapter 10, or among Christians, Tertullian, John Chrysostom, is that Jonah feared being labeled a false prophet. This interpretation is inspired by Deuteronomy 18, verse 22. If what a prophet proclaims in the name of the Lord does not take place or come true, that is a message the Lord has not spoken. That prophet has spoken presumptuously, so do not be alarmed. As already noted, however, this interpretation does not conform to the general Israelite or ancient Near Eastern understanding of prophecy. As put very aptly by Eagleton, quote, the only successful prophet is an ineffectual one, one whose warnings fail to materialize. What they have done is to produce a state of affair, in which the state of affairs they describe won't be the case. Effective declarations of imminent catastrophe cancel themselves out, containing, as they do, a contradiction between what they say and what they do. Another interpretation, also shared by Jews and Christians, is that Jonah fled because he feared that Israel would be unfavorably compared with the people of Nineveh. If the Ninevites repented, then their repentance would point an accusing finger at sinful Israel, with the result that Jonah would have been instrumental in bringing about Israel's terrible condemnation. According to this interpretation, Jonah's behavior was, if not fully laudable, at least principled. Jerome, for example, compares Jonah's disobedience to God with Moses' expressed willingness to die on behalf of Israel, as we have in Exodus 32, 31-32. Likewise, Theodore Mopsuestia explains Jonah's decision to flee as an act of compassion. Like Paul in Romans 9, verses 1-5, who preferred being cut off for Christ for the sake of his brothers, Jonah's flight stemmed from his desire to save his people. The Jewish sages and medieval Jewish commentators not only adhere to this line of interpretation, but give it an even more positive slant. In Mechilta, attributed to Rabbi Ishmael, 1:13, for example, Jonah becomes a martyr for Israel, who had to choose between obeying God and defending Israel's honor. To shield Israel from God's anger, Jonah chose not to go to Nineveh. Instead, like Moses in Exodus 32, Jonah was willing to give his life for Israel's survival. Other traditions are prevalent in one religious tradition only. A few Jewish exegetes understand Jonah's flight against the background of the Assyrian, from Jonah's perspective, future destruction of the northern kingdom of Israel. This interpretation is informed by the reference to Jonah ben Amittai in 2 Kings 14:25, according to which Jonah was active during the reign of Jeroboam II in the 8th century BCE. Abarbanel, for example, states that Jonah did not want to go to Nineveh, for he knew of the future difficulties which would befall the 10 tribes of the northern kingdom of Israel. Therefore, he closed his soul to God's call for the purpose that the nations of Assyria and Nineveh, its capital, would be destroyed. In other words, Jonah, being a prophet, knew that Assyria would soon threaten the northern kingdom. Therefore, by refusing to prophesy, lest he should encourage the Ninevites to repent, Jonah sought to ensure Nineveh's destruction and concurrently to safeguard Israel's survival. In fact, Jonah fully expected his disobedience to cost him his life, as he would under normal circumstances had drowned in the sea when being tossed overboard by the sailors. While the relatively positive estimate of Jonah continues in Jewish interpretations of Jonah 4, the Christian interpretive counterpart becomes outspokenly anti-Jewish. In his German commentary to Jonah 4:1, Luther states unequivocally that Jonah, as a representative of the Jews, was upset because he begrudged the Gentiles the privilege of becoming Christians. Jonah would have deplored the implication that Judaism was unnecessary and their laws useless, according to Luther, a logical conclusion of the Ninevites' salvation, as he would have understood it as a way of deprecating and disparaging his fellow countrymen. Turning to the sailors, both Jews and Christians have appealed to the sailors in Jonah 1 in polemical debate. Let us begin with the far more prevalent anti-Jewish sentiments among many Christian interpreters. Before we can appreciate this exegetical tradition, however, we need to discuss the widespread Christian typological understanding of Jonah, which has its roots in the reference to the sign of the prophet of Jonah in Matthew 12:39 and Luke 11:30. So I'll just read it. Then some of the Pharisees and teachers of the law said to him, "Teacher, we want to see a sign from you." He answered, "A wicked and adulterous generation asks for a sign, but none will be given it except the sign of the prophet Jonah. For as Jonah was 3 days and 3 nights in the belly of a huge fish, So the Son of Man will be 3 nights and 3 days in the heart of the earth. The men of Nineveh will stand up at the judgment with this generation and condemn it, for they repented at the preaching of Jonah, and now something greater than Jonah is here. In Luke 11:30 is a bit shorter. This rather opaque statement has given rise to a three-part typology that, one, Jonah being tossed into the sea by the sailors is a precursor for Jesus' crucifixion. Two, Jonah's 3 days inside the belly of the fish is a precursor for Jesus' death. And three, Jonah being vomited out by the fish is a precursor for Jesus' resurrection. Overall, as we can see, for example, on this painting, Jonah becomes a Christ figure, and this is reflected in much Christian art. This typology has often lent itself to anti-Jewish replacement theology. In a short reflection of Jonah, Adam of Saint Victor, a French poet and composer who died in 1146, states, "In the story of the whale, Jonah fugitive, figures forth the true Jonah. After 3 days, he came alive. From the whale's narrow belly, the flower of synagogue withers, and that of ecclesia blooms." For this typology to work, the sailors are in parallel turned into types as well as anti-types, namely as precursors for the Jews who wish to condemn Jesus to death. Beginning with the anti-types, many Christian exegetes have compared the sailors with the Jews at the time of Jesus to the detriment of the latter. As Jerome writes, "They," the sailors in Jonah, "refused to shed blood, preferring rather to die than kill. Oh, how changed they are now. The people that served God are now," imply, "saying, crucify him, crucify him." Turning to the types, a significantly smaller group of Christian retellings, just equally anti-Jewish in their outlook, depict the sailors as brutal Jewish men willing and ready to kill Jonah. Needless to say, this type of retelling is completely unsupported by the biblical narrative. In Herkeberga Church in Sweden, for example, the medieval German-Swedish painter Albrecht Målare, Latinized as Albertus Pictus, from the 15th century, has painted the sailors as cruel men with grotesque noses and conical hats, both aspects associated with European medieval Jewry, and you can see a picture on how they look like there. The onlookers would, as a result, have interpreted Jonah 1:13 as a precursor to the Passion narrative. The sailors, slash the Jews, killed Jonah, slash Jesus. Jewish interpreters have reacted to the Christian anti-Jewish polemic. Anew, we meet two different rejoinders. Positively, the sailors become Jews, antitypes. Negatively, the sailors become persecuting Christians, types. Beginning with the former, Pirkei de Rabbi Eliezer, chapter 10, followed by Rashi, notably turns the sailors into Jews. The impetus is Jonah 1:16. As the sailors saw all the miracles that God did to Jonah, meaning the salvation by the fish, they abandoned their idolatry, returned to Yafo, went up to Jerusalem, and circumcised the flesh of their foreskins. This is not really in the Bible, but I'll explain how we get there. The rationale behind this interpretation is twofold. First, the term sacrifice is reinterpreted to refer to the blood of the covenant shed during circumcision. Second, as sacrifices can only be offered in the temple, and as only Jews can offer sacrifices, the sailors almost by default must have converted to Judaism. To emphasize their conversion, PRE 10 ends with a reference to the 13th blessing of the Amidah, the central prayer in Jewish liturgy containing 19 blessings. That is to pray for the welfare of the righteous converts. As argued by Rachel Edelman, the conversion of the sailors in PRE 10 is part of the wider anti-Christian polemic in Pirkei de Rabbi Eliezer. The sailors serve as a counterpoint to those Jews mentioned disparagingly in Matthew 12:39, due to their failure to believe in Jesus. The sailor of Jonah 1 do not become Christians, they become Jews. Turning to the types, in his novel, The Strange Nation of Rafael Mendes, inspired by the Jonah narrative, the Jewish-Brazilian author Moser Scliar portrays the sailors as outspoken Jew haters who actively wishes to throw the Christ killer, namely Jonah, overboard. In his retelling, the Gentile sailors are thus read and interpreted through the lens of 2,000 years of Christian persecution of Jews. Jonah 2:9 in your English translation is Jonah 2:8. Meshamrim havlei shav chastam ya'azovu. Those who observe the vapors of vanity forsake their goodness. This obscure statement has rather unexpectedly constituted a battlefield between Jewish and Christian interpreters. The problem stems from the uncertain identity of the addressees. To whom does the psalmist refer? What are they doing? And what is their goodness, chastam, that they are forsaking? Two main lines of exegesis prevail. While Jewish interpreters tend to identify the people referred to with the Gentile sailors of Jonah 1, many Christian interpreters categorize them, their goodness, as that of the Jews. So, in traditional Jewish interpretation, the word vanity is understood as a euphemism for idols. In Jonah 2:9, the category of those who observe the vapors of vanity is parallel with the ones who abandon their goodness. In other words, to abandon their goodness is another way of saying that they worshipped idols. When we read Jonah 2 in isolation, and most modern scholars do that, this interpretation is very straightforward and in line with the sentiments expressed elsewhere in the Hebrew Bible. The problem arises, however, if we read Jonah 2:9 as an integral part of the surrounding Jonah narrative. The only people in the book of Jonah who are explicitly described as worshipping other gods are the Gentile sailors in Jonah 1:5. Yet they are overall depicted in a very favorable light throughout Jonah 1. The sentiment here in Jonah 2:9, interpreted in its wider context of the book of Jonah, is thus incongruous with the portrayal of the sailors in Jonah 1. As those of us who work in reception history, we know that just because something is problematic doesn't mean that it has not been done. So it hasn't hindered Exodus from going down this route at all. Rashi, for example, maintains that the sailors used to worship idols, and the term chastam, goodness, refers to their past acts of kindness towards these idols. Now, however, they have abandoned such folly and instead follow the God of Israel. In contrast, Ibn Ezra maintains that the term chastam refers to the sailors' act of throwing Jonah into the sea, thinking it was an act of kindness. Yet again, Radak envisages Jonah reflecting upon the sailors. The sailors believed in the Lord for a brief time only, and then they returned to their idolatry soon afterwards. In contrast, many Christian interpreters have used this verse in their anti-Jewish polemic by identifying the term vanity, chavlei shav, as a reference to rabbinical Judaism. According to Jerome, Jonah 2:9 speaks prophetically about such Jews who endeavor to observe the precepts of mankind and the commandment of the Pharisees, all of which is vanity. Luther likewise associates the adherers of vanity with the people of Israel. In his view, Jonah rebukes, quote, the foolish work righteous and hypocrites who do not rely solely on God's grace, but on their own work, end quote. In this way, Jonah speaks prophetically about his fellow Israelites, quote, who relied on the law and on the works, and who do not only snub the gospel of God's grace, but also persecute it, end quote. The people of Nineveh, they are the darlings of much Christian exegesis. Notwithstanding Jonah's meager one-liner of a sermon, they believed his message, turned to the God of Israel, and repented of their sins. Many Christian exegetes accordingly used the Ninevites' penitence in their anti-Jewish polemic. In his dialogue with Trifle, Justin Martyr offers a scathing comparison. I'll try to read this, but he doesn't put in a lot of commas and full stops. I would give him a bad mark for that if I marked his writing, but I'm not. I'll try. And though all the men of your nation knew the incidents in the life of Jonah, and though Christ said amongst you that he would give the sign of Jonah, exhorting you to repent on your wicked deeds at least after he rose again from the dead, and to mourn before God as did the Ninevites, in order that your nation and city might not be taken and destroyed as they have been destroyed. Yet you not only have not repented after you learned that he rose from the dead, but, as I said before, you have sent chosen and ordained men throughout all the world to proclaim that a godless and lawless heresy had sprung from one Jesus, a Galilean receiver, whom we crucified, but his disciples stole him by night from the tomb where he was laid when unfastened from the cross, and now deceiving men by asserting that he has risen from the dead and ascended to heaven. Full stop. Don't ever write a sentence like this. More briefly, Jerome comments that Nineveh believed, but not Israel. The foreskin believed, but circumcision remained without faith. Likewise, Cyril of Alexandria, in his commentary to Jonah 3:5, compares the behavior of the people of Nineveh with that of Israel. While this was the situation of the Ninevites, however, Israel, in its stupidity, did not obey the law, mocking the provisions of Moses and setting no store by the statements of the prophet. Why do I claim that? They also turned killers of the Lord, not even believing Christ himself, savior of us all. Later in his commentary, he anew compares the behavior of the people of Nineveh in Jonah 3:8 with that of Israel. Now the Ninevites were very wise, devoting themselves to an abandonment of depravity by means of fasting, this being the single authentic and blameless form of repentance. Since Israel, by contrast, did not possess a faculty for it, and sometimes gave evidence of a fasting that was ill-considered and profane, God ordered the prophets to raise his voice and proclaim to them, "This is not the fasting that I have chosen," says the Lord. Now we are in Isaiah 58. Ephraim, the Syrian, he lived in the 4th century, wrote a long metrical homily called The Repentance of Nineveh, replete with anti-Jewish sentiment. In chapter 5, Jonah is amazed at the reformation of the Ninevites, in contrast to the sinful behavior of his own people. Chapter 6 continues in the same vein as Jonah enumerates the sins of Israel. And again, remember, this is a quote. When Jonah looked on Nineveh, she gathered her sons together as a church. All Nineveh was purified. The fast in the midst of her was held in honor. But the holy temple in Zion, they had made a den of robbers. He looked on Nineveh, and the king paid adoration unto God. He looked at Jeroboam, and he was worshipping the calves. The sins of the Ninevites made them tremble with loud crying before God. The Hebrews sacrificed their sons, and offered up their sons to devils. In their fasting, the Ninevites poured out their wines. From the Ninevites there was perceived the fair savour of morning, but in the midst of Zion there breathed the perfume and incense of idols. This type of anti-Jewish comparisons persist in Protestant interpretation. In his German commentary to Jonah, Luther contrasts Nineveh's behavior favorably with that of Jerusalem at the time of Jesus. To emphasize his point, Luther draws attention to Jesus' word to the centurion in Matthew 8:10 of not having encountered such faith in all of Israel. Along similar lines, the 18th century English Congregational minister Thomas Bradbury cites Matthew 12:41 into his sermon on Nineveh's repentance to emphasize that whereas the people of Nineveh believed Jonah, a mere messenger, and repented of their sins, the people of Israel neither believed nor repented despite hearing Jesus, the Son of God, in person. A similar type of anti-Jewish polemic is also tested in many other sermons, among them one by Joseph Saville, preached in Boston in 1740. The wrath of God came upon them to the uttermost by the Romans, and they are made an execration and a curse until this day. Jewish interpreters responded, one might say naturally, to this type of polemic by casting doubts upon the sincerity and longevity of the Ninevites' repentance. This line of exegesis stems from three sources. First, informed by the Book of Nahum and, you might say, general knowledge of world history, Jewish scholars emphasized Nineveh's destruction in 612 BCE by, among other, Babylonian and Median forces. If Nineveh was destroyed so soon after Jonah's visit to the city, so the argument goes, whatever remorse the Ninevites felt was clearly short-lived. Targum Jonathan, for example, adds the word in the end to his translation of Jonah 4:5, when Jonah is sitting waiting to see what would happen to Nineveh in the end, ultimately. More precisely, Pirkei de Rabbi Eliezer, chapter 43, states that the Ninevites' repentance lasted exactly 40 years. For 40 years, the Holy One, blessed be He, was slow to anger with them, corresponding to the 40 days which He said to Jonah, in another 40 days, Nineveh shall be overthrown. After 40 years, they returned to their many evil deeds, more so than their former ones, and they were swallowed up like the dead in the lowest Sheol. As they say, men groan in the city, the souls of the dead cry out. That's a quote from Job 24, verse 12. As argued by Edelman, this passage may be understood as a polemic against the concept of a sign of Jonah as found in Matthew 12 and Luke 11, what I showed you before. According to these two passages, the people of Nineveh would rise and judge the Jews at the time of Jesus. According to Pirkei de Rabbi Eliezer 43, however, the repentance of the people of Nineveh was short-lived. Thus, rather than judging anyone, they can be found in the deepest level of the netherworld. A few later retellings of the Jonah narrative expand on this insight. In the poem The Jaffa Road, part of his longer poem Jonah, the Jewish South African poet Lewis Snowden writes, it took 100 years or more, while heaven's patience held, to fetch a sword for Nineveh, as Jonah had forespelled. Then was that city ripped with flood, and raked with hammer and hood. The only monument to stand is Jonah and his book. Second, informed by the references to fasting animals in Jonah 3:7, many rabbis deem the decision not to give animal sustenance to be a sign of the Ninevites' inherent insincerity and cruelty. As stated in the Jerusalem Talmud, the the Ninevites acted cruelly towards their animals so as to force the animals to cry out, thus explaining Jonah 3:8. Said Rabbi Shimon ben Lachish, the repentance that the men of Nineveh carried out was deceitful. What did they do? Rabbi Chuna, in the name of Rabbi Shimon ben Chalaputa, they set up calves inside with the mothers outside, lambs inside with the mothers outside, and these bellowed from here and those bellowed from there. They said, if we are not shown mercy, we shall not have mercy on them. This is in line with that which was written, how the beasts groan. The herds of cattle are perplexed because there is no pasture for them. Even the flocks of sheep are dismayed. Said Rabbi Aha, in Arabia, that is how they act towards their beasts, treating them cruelly. But let men and beasts be covered with sackcloth, and let them cry out mightily to God. Yes, let everyone turn from his evil ways and from the violence which is at his hands. The Babylonian Talmud to the same Mishnah concurs. It repeats the accusation of cruelty towards animals and children and emphasizes how the people of Nineveh began to bargain with God, saying that unless God had mercy on them, they would not have mercy on their animals and not also on their children. Let them be covered with sackcloth, both men and beast. What did they do? They set beasts by themselves and children by themselves, and said before him, Lord of the world, if you don't have mercy on us, we shall not have mercy on these. Third, anew inspired by a very literal understanding of the phrase, and they called out mightily to God in Jonah 3:8, a few Jewish interpreters maintain that the people of Nineveh remained cruel, even in their so-called repentance. Rashi, for example, taking the statement Bechaska to mean with force rather than understood as an adverb. And he argues that the men of Nineveh separated children from their mothers with force and stated to God that if you don't show us mercy, we will not show mercy to these hostages. I promised you the worm, and I will deliver. The statement in Jonah 4:7, and God appointed a worm when the dawn rose the next morning, has given rise to what must be one of the most peculiar and also one of the most anti-Jewish interpretations in the reception history of the book of Jonah, namely that the worm is a type for either Christ or the gospel, while the kikayon, the gourd or whatever it is, represents the old covenant. The impetus for this interpretation is Psalm 22, verse 6, where the psalmist states, I am a worm and not a man. This interpretation is advocated by many of the church fathers. Augustine, for example, speaks of the morning worm that caused the old covenant to wither away by the coming of Jesus and the forging of the new covenant. Wherefore the shadow of that gourd over his head prefigured the promises of the Old Testament, or rather the privileges already enjoyed in it, in which there was, as the apostle says, a shadow of things to come, furnishing, as it were, a refuge from the heat of temporal calamities in the land of promise. Moreover, in that morning worm, which by his gnawing tooth made the gourd wither away, Christ himself is again prefigured, for as much as by the publication of the gospel from his mouth, all those things which flourished among the Israelites for a time, or with a shadowy symbolic meaning in that earlier dispensation, are now deprived of their significance and have withered away. Am I imagining it? No. If we look at the 16th chapter, you do see the significance of the plant there. So the plant was considered a sign of the old covenant that then became redundant. This interpretation is taken up by none other than Luther, who argues that Jesus is the worm that God appoints. Jesus attacks the plant, which is the law, and abolishes it through the Holy Spirit. As a result, quote, Judaism withered and decayed in all the world, and thus we see it today. Its verdure is gone, it flourishes no longer, nor is there a saint or a prophet sitting in its shade today. Its day is spent. End quote. In support of his interpretation, Luther cites the aforementioned verse, Psalm 22, verse 6. The fall of Judaism took place at dawn, quote, on the day of grace of the New Testament, end quote. Last but not least, Jewish and Christian interpreters at times disagree about the ultimate message of the book of Jonah. Christian interpreters go with the surface meaning of the book of Jonah. It's all about giving sinners a second chance and the power of repentance. It's also about extending God's compassion beyond Israel and to the Gentiles. It is difficult to argue with this interpretation. Yet just because it's difficult doesn't mean that it cannot or should not be done. Such endeavors bring us back to where we started, namely Jonah 4:2 and Jonah's reason for running away. The interpreters in this group are predominantly, but by no means exclusively, Jewish. The main issue that these interpreters have with the book of Jonah is God's perceived lack of justice. Levin, for example, argues that Jonah is dissatisfied with, quote, God's juridical posture, end quote. What God advocates in Jonah is a situation where no equivalent suffering, no compensatory good deed, and no expiatory right is needed for Nineveh to obtain forgiveness. Furthermore, it opens the questions of God's right in the first place to forgive an evil that was not done towards him, but towards the victims of Nineveh's evil. Jonah's dialogue with God can thus be read as an example of the human struggle against injustice. Other retellings address the open ending of the book of Jonah. Does Jonah accept God's perspective or not? In his novel, Profeten Jonas Privat, the Danish Harald Tandrup, 1874 to 1964, envisages Jonah's ultimate non-acceptance of God's perspective and describes it as a positive development. His retelling ends with Jonah standing up to God and questioning the point of it all. What is the point when God does not punish the guilty? What is the point when the godless prospers while those who fear God and walk the path of righteousness receive at most a meager reward? Never again will he be reckoned among those who praise his name. Instead, Jonah has become one of the great doubters. To conclude, the slim book of Jonah has been and still is a very potent theological creation. It has been interpreted, reinterpreted, and misinterpreted, and used as a powerful tool in Jewish-Christian polemic throughout the ages. Christian interpreters have generally upheld the surface meaning of the book, where the sailors are good, the Ninevites are role models, Jonah is a rather disagreeable character, and God is an ever-loving, compassionate, and willing to give all sinners a second chance. In contrast, many Jewish interpreters have explored the less overt aspects of the book. What are the implications of the identification of Jonah with a prophet during the reign of Jeroboam II? Why is the end of the book of Jonah counterfactual when read together with the book of Nahum and general knowledge? Why does the book end with an ambiguous divine statement that can be read, but does not need to be read as a rhetorical question? It can be argued that Jewish interpreters were pushed into this defensive position because of Christian polemic. Jewish readers may not have gone down these routes had it not been for the Christian appropriation of the book. Yet it is equally true that their problematization of the overarching message of the book of Jonah leaves us later readers enriched. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed for this fantastic lecture. I will use my chair's prerogative to start off the discussion and give those of you who are not entirely sure yet how to word your question, a minute or two to do so. In my question, I would like to ask you to sort of speculate and think a little bit further about what the book of Jonah, how that might relate to our own days. In the last couple of days, a former judge of the German Supreme Court, he has a regular column in the Süddeutsche Zeitung, which is sort of left-leaning liberal daily, brought the book of Jonah to bear on the situation, the continuing situation of refugees trying to cross the Mediterranean, and linked Jonah's cry, Jonah's psalm, to the cry for help of those who are drowning in the Mediterranean. And I wonder whether you've seen anybody in your research, anybody who's tried to bring any of their current calamities that they were encountering to bear on their own reading of the book, or whether the readings really are all, as it were, typological, mythologized readings into the distant past that might have something more generally theological, systematic, but not, as it were, to the current day.
Thank you very much for this question. I would say that the interpreters that I address today are predominantly traditional, in a sense, even though I touched upon some more modern ones. I think what you references to brings to my mind, at least, Conrad's reading of the Jonah narrative. Joseph Conrad wrote a series of novels and short stories where he talks about sailors. And in several of his books and short and novellas, he problematizes the sailor's behavior because he asks, what are the responsibilities of the sailors? Should they have tossed Jonah overboard? Some traditional readings, I mean, the sailors do come out fairly well when we read the Jonah narrative, but there is still this lingering thought that wouldn't it have been more honorable if they had not tossed Jonah overboard? To the point that there is even a Hellenistic sermon where you have Jonah jumping overboard, basically rescuing the sailors from having to toss him. So Jonah himself commits suicide in order to save the sailors from having to commit murder. But Joseph Conrad, he really problematizing this, and he says, okay, if you have a ship, and there is even one book, I've forgotten the name of it, where you have not refugees, or you have I think it's nearly refugees. You have a group of Chinese people are trying to get from A to B. And there is a storm, and in the end, the crew sacrifices these Chinese guests, as you may say, thinking, okay, they are not as important as our crew. So this story plays in sort of who is worth more, and this group of Chinese, let's call them refugees, but are then considered not to be as important as the crew, so they sacrifice them. What then ultimately happens is that they are saved by another boat, and then the court, the sailors, are trying to be brought to justice. But I think it's a very interesting question of what are your responsibility towards another human being that is your guest, regardless of whether he has paid or not to be on board? Do you toss them overboard in order to save your own skin, or do you, in contrast to the sailors, actually keep them on board because it is not right? So I think many modern readings problematize the sailors, even though reluctant, but nevertheless, that they tossed Jonah overboard.
Thank you very much. I will hand the microphone to whoever asked the first question, and I wonder whether I could ask Freddie to then jump around with the microphone. Is that okay? I'm so sorry to jump that on you. Do we have a first question? I will put people on the spot.
Julia Sophia, thank you so much. It was fascinating, fascinating insight into this story. And I'm working at trying to, there are all sorts of things I'm thinking and I'm trying to put them into a question. One of the things that was apparent to me most as you were going through these interpretations was how essentially self-serving they are, mm-hmm. interpretations of a story which in itself is written pretty much to some extent against self-interests. At the least, this is an Israelite story mm-hmm. in which the non-Israelites somehow get it in a way in which the Israelites don't. But for the purposes, I think, of exploring a whole lot mm-hmm. of questions about justice, but it parallels some of the stories in many of the stories in Genesis, for example, mm-hmm. where you get foreign kings who are lorded against the action of raised up above the kind of sort of things that Abraham will do, for example. So I'm struck by this difference in the story, a story which is prepared to weigh questions and to ask questions about oneself and to be self-critical against these interpretations that you've seen, which seem to be, from what you've presented, inherently about supporting us against them.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm wondering also, like you probably, where is the question in that? But at the end, your conclusions brought out a whole lot more ambiguous and really interesting interpretations. So you've presented us with some of the things which stand out and have been fascinating to hear. You must have seen an extraordinary mix of approaches to interpreting this story.
Yes, I have, absolutely. And the more I read, the more the story develops for me. When I started with Jonah, I thought the book of Jonah was a fairly easy story, but I don't think so anymore. And if people ask me, what is the message of the book of Jonah? I have to confess, I don't know. I really, really don't know. And the one thing that strikes me, and why I say that I don't know, is that whereas many of these interpreters take at face value the pre-exilic dating of the book of Jonah, they identify Jonah with Jonah ben Amittai during the reign of Jeroboam II, and that is before the Neo-Assyrian Empire was destroyed. So from their perspective, it isn't really a problem. But when I look at it from an historical critical perspective, and I firmly think that this is a book that was written in the post-monarchic period, meaning we are probably in the 6th century, possibly even later, that brings up a can of worms, to use the term worm again. What does it mean that someone wrote the book of Jonah with what I would perceive to be a counterfactual ending? The people in post-monarchic Judah would have known that Nineveh was in ruins. I mean, we would be naive to think that they weren't aware of that. So I think the message of the book of Jonah is not as straightforward as I thought it was before. Yes, they repented, but they are not a flourishing city now. No, it's a city in ruins. And that ties in with what I think is the open ending. I see Jonah, the book of Jonah, as almost like a wisdom narrative that debates God's compassion and how much it's worth, and God's right to have compassion, knowing that by being compassionate, the people of Nineveh were saved, so that they could go on and destroy the northern kingdom, but then ultimately they were destroyed again. So I honestly don't know what the message of the book of Jonah is. I keep turning it back and forth. Yes, of course, it is about compassion. And yes, of course, it is about giving someone a second chance. But it's also about, well, if you do that, it's it's not uncomplicated doing that. Yeah.
Thank you very much. I just, your last comment was very important, because this is what I'd like to address, because I'd like to address the sort of context of the book itself rather than more than its reception history. So there is a problem with this, viewing this book within a historical framework, and that is that Nineveh itself was founded really by Sennacherib. And by that time, the northern Israel kingdom had already been invaded by the Assyrians.
Yes.
So it's really, that is already a problem. And the other problem is this, that Nineveh collapsed in a very short period, in a very surprising quick period of time, without any obvious enemies. This was an internal problem between Assyrians and Babylonians. And before that, there was no evidence that any enemies would be able to conquer this great city. So it would have been a bit like the collapse of communism. Nobody anticipated it, and suddenly just collapsed. So then if you think about a story about this, it would be absurd to think that that Nineveh would ever collapse before 612.
Yeah.
No one would ever believe it, because it's such a great, mighty city.
Yeah.
And of course, that no one would ever believe that Nineveh would ever repent. Why should it repent? Repent for what? So the whole premise about why this book is written is already a problem. And the other problem is that prophets don't act in this way. A prophet is not an institutional figure. He's an extra institutional figure. So we don't have prophets being asked by God to go and give prophecies or do things. They're supposed to predict. They're not supposed to change alter what's going to happen. So the whole story is a highly problematic kind of novel or novella.
It is. And as I've already confessed, after spending more than 4 years battling with this book, I am less near in any major insight than I was when I started. But yes, I do think it's important to highlight that Nineveh was destroyed. People would have known that it was destroyed. It was destroyed, as you said, in a very unexpected manner. Also about Jonah as a character, you're right, prophets don't behave that way. And people have tried to see this as a satirical book. Does it make fun of prophets? Or does it criticize the Israelite prophets? Or is it actually a funny story? Because you have animals dressed in sackcloth. I mean, it is a bit absurd. I have looked at all these interpretations, and again, I iterate, I disagree with them. I don't think this is a funny story at all. I think it's a very, very serious story, and I think it is a story about God's right to grant justice to whomever he pleases, but how that divine right is deeply problematic for human beings. And the book of Jonah is a way of grappling with the seeming lack of justice. We want justice. We want the good to prosper and the bad to be punished. At least most people want that. And but God acts in a different way. So I would almost put Jonah on par with Job in this perspective, and say also in Job, God acts, you might even say capriciously. He acts in a way that he sees fit. And humanity doesn't understand. So the difference is that Job quite clearly accepts God's right to act capriciously. Jonah, well, we don't know. We have no idea what Jonah does after 4:11. I've looked at a number of retellings and how some retellings, for example, you have some traditional ones like Vita Prophetarum, for example, has the lives of the prophets. There Jonah goes back settles with his mom in Tyre. I mean, it's a whole story about what Jonah does afterwards. But it seems like Jonah goes back, continues to be a prophet and a God-fearing one. To take a very, very, very different retelling, there is a Christian American, I would say, evangelical television franchise called VeggieTales. Some of you may have encountered VeggieTales, some of you may not have. Anyway, their first feature film was called Jonah. And they end the Jonah story differently. Their Jonah rides away from Israel, away from God, on his camel, clearly indicating that he's not willing to go with Jonah's perspective, with God's perspective. And then you have other books, like a bit, people have added endings. This book by Tandrup, for example, sees Jonah's resistance to God's perspective as a triumph. No, I will not accept God's capriciousness, and that's a good development. But then you have other retellings where Jonah resists God's perspective, and that's considered a very negative development. There's a very powerful opera, for example, where it ends with lots of music, and it says that Jonah tried, God was speaking, but the only thing that Jonah heard was noise and storm, and he goes away filled with storm and noise, and the music then contributes to that. So it's open-ended, and it problematizes the message of the book. Do we accept God's capriciousness, his right to show mercy, or don't we? So Jonah becomes a bit of a sort of a interlocutor to Job.
Thank you very much indeed. I really enjoyed that. I wanted to pick up the 4:11, and I also wanted to pick up the humour, so actually it comes up by what you were just saying. But before I even say that, I was very interested in your answer there, which told us what the book of Jonah was about, in contrast to your answer before, when you told us you didn't know what it was about. I think I agree with what you were saying in the second one, but it has always, you mentioned the VeggieTales thing. Mm-hmm. I've done some stuff for Channel 4, which did a whole set of cartoons of biblical stories and so on, and obviously Jonah is a classic one that you do. So one was looking at exactly the same things, and there is an awful lot of humour in it. You know, the fact that God says go this way and he goes that way, and I love the bit when he gets a paddy and says, look, I knew this was what was going to happen. I knew you were compassionate. I knew you were going to be nice to people. I said it. And you can almost sort of see him stamping his foot. So, I mean, the humour is being used in a very powerful way to make that point. And the little thing I just wanted to ask, though, about, does that help us at all with 4:11? With all the research you've done on it, I have never understood why the last two words are, and many animals. Romany Cairns, all right, or whatever. But you know, you say the idea of them wearing sackcloth is crazy as well. And yes. it's an extraordinary ending. That these people who don't know their left hand from the right hand.
And all the animals. Yeah.
And the insights.
Well, the funny thing is that both Christian and Jewish interpreters have understood not knowing their left hand from their right hand as a sign that these people were actually infants. Because only infants can't differentiate between their right and left hand. So we have so and so many infants and animals. I'm not saying that this interpretation is correct, but what it does is that it emphasizes the innocence of the inhabitants. So let's go for a moment with the idea that people who don't know their left from the right are actually children. And then the animals would fit in a sense that we are talking about collateral damage here. We are talking about creatures entities that have not done anything wrong at all. The children have not been, are not old enough to have committed any sins. The parents, yes, but not the children. And the animals have certainly not committed any sins. So I think it is about collateral damage. Yes, it seems to me that God is saying, I can punish the wicked, but when you want me to punish the whole city, I'm not only going to punish the wicked, I'm also going to punish the innocent. And that is also not just. So God is in a bind, in a sense. If he punishes Nineveh, yes, he's doing the just thing because Nineveh is a wicked city, but he's also doing something unjust because he's punishing the innocent. So I think that last verse with the animals actually then emphasize, I think, the collateral damage that any punitive divine action ultimately include. And that, of course, brings us back to Genesis 19 and Abraham arguing with God. I mean, if there are 50, if there are 40, if there are 30, if there are 20. I mean, it's all about God's justice. When can God punish? And when should he have compassion? And both options are not ideal.
Just a quick note that actually that's the question of the flood, the collateral damage. So you have exactly the same question and the same matter and the same issue there.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Can you repeat your?
The collateral damage matter, yes. You mentioned. Well, the same matter as when you analyze the narrative of the flood.
Oh, the flood. Thank you. Yes. Absolutely. I agree with you. The flood, and again, I've done some work on the flood because I'm really interested in the idea of God's justice versus God's compassion. And what's interesting is when you look at the reception history of Genesis 6 to 9, these same questions come up. And again, there is an interesting divide between, again, I generalize, because you need to generalize in a reception history, between Jewish and Christian approaches. In most Christian approaches, Noah preaches repentance to the people. He doesn't do that in the Bible. In the Bible, he just builds the ark and doesn't say anything. But in Christian tradition, he's out there preaching repentance, but the people don't listen to him, thus justifying God sending the flood. In most Jewish interpretation, Noah intercedes on behalf of the people. But so that is interesting. That almost shifts the blame a bit onto God. He intercedes, but God says, no, I'm not listening to this intercession. But in both traditions, you have Noah actually doing something, in contrast to the biblical narrative where he doesn't do anything. And when you look at fictional, just out of interest, I've read a lot of Noah novels or flood novels. And all of them are deeply uncomfortable with Noah's lack of action. And some of them bring in exactly either preaching repentance or intercessory prayer in order to make Noah more of a mensch. A few of them are really scary, because they have Noah exactly as he's depicted in the Bible. He doesn't do a thing. The particular one children's book, or sort of, is called Not the End of the World. I'm very bad remembering names. Anyway, the opening statement of the book says, it takes a long time for humanity to die. And it's a very heartbreaking scene of Noah closing the door to the ark. The water is rising, and you have people clinging to the ark, trying to get in, trying to climb up onto the ark, and they are being pushed away. Because only Noah and his family are supposed to be saved. And slowly, slowly, people are dying around the ark. It's a very, very poignant scene. And it brings up exactly those questions. I mean, when is it just, when is it not just? What is collateral damage? And in the flood, absolutely.
I think with that, on that perhaps slightly scary note, we shall close the questions. We have gone from Jonah to Job to Genesis. I also heard a little bit of Amos in the last thing about intercession and lack thereof or non-acceptance by God. I think we should return back to Genesis